Hello and welcome back. In this episode, I will demonstrate a rapid clinical assessment of the 12-lead electrocardiogram, covering 30 different ECG presentations that you need to know. There's lots to cover here, so let's dive straight in. Always start by checking the name of the patient, their age and gender. Review previous electrocardiograms and the clinical history, as this may provide vital clues that will help you to form your diagnosis. Confirm that the ECG is set to 25 millimeters per second. This is really important because the remaining interpretation relies on this ECG setting. We now move on to interpretation of the ECG, starting with the rate. First, locate the rhythm strip on the lower part of the ECG trace. Determine the rate by counting the number of R waves and multiplying this by 6. In this example, the ventricular rate is 72 beats per minute. A normal heart rate typically ranges between 60 to 100 beats per minute. A rate that falls below 60 beats per minute is referred to as a bradycardia. A rate exceeding 100 beats per minute is referred to as a tachycardia. Rate and rhythm are evaluated simultaneously, so while calculating the rate, it is important to observe whether the R waves are evenly spaced. If they are evenly spaced, the rhythm is considered regular. But the rhythm can also be regularly irregular or irregularly irregular. The most common rhythm you will see is sinus rhythm. Sinus rhythm is confirmed when the rate is between 60 and 100 beats per minute. The rhythm is regular and P waves are positive and precede each QRS complex. The QRS complex should be narrow with normal morphology. Anything that does not match this criteria is considered an arrhythmia. Let's take a look at some of the bradycardias and tachycardias so you know what to look out for. We'll start with the bradycardias. So all the bradycardias will have a rate of less than 60 beats per minute. They can be divided into regular and irregular rhythms, but there are subtle features that you can learn to help you determine the underlying diagnosis. If the rhythm is regular, P waves are positive and a single P wave precedes each QRS complex, this is sinus bradycardia. If the rhythm is regular but there are no P waves preceding the QRS complexes, this is a junctional escape rhythm. If the rhythm is irregular and there is a pause of more than 2 seconds, which is the equivalent of 10 large squares, then this is likely sinus arrest. You can confirm the diagnosis by measuring the number of squares, starting at the first P wave and ending at the beginning of the next P wave. Remember, it must be more than 10 large squares to be significant. Finally, an irregular rhythm where there are P waves followed by no QRS complex is likely to be an atrioventricular heart block, either second degree or third degree. But don't worry, we'll cover the heart blocks in more detail soon. Let's take a look at the tachycardias. Tachycardias are classified by the shape and duration of the QRS complex. Narrow complex tachycardias have a QRS complex less than 3 small squares in duration. These tachycardias typically originate from the atria. Broad complex tachycardias originate from the ventricles. The complexes here have a longer duration of greater than 3 small squares. Let's take a look at the narrow complex tachycardias. So all of these have a rate greater than 100 beats per minute, and they will have narrow QRS complexes. By identifying a few simple features, you'll be able to clinch the diagnosis. If the rhythm is regular, the P waves are upright, and a single P wave precedes each QRS complex, you have a sinus tachycardia. If the rhythm is regular and sawtooth-like flutter waves are present, this is atrial flutter. If the rhythm is regular, but you are unable to identify any P waves, it is likely that they are buried within the QRS complex and is a presentation of an atrioventricular nodal reentrant tachycardia. If the rhythm is regular, but you can see the P waves occurring after the QRS complex, these are known as retrograde P waves. This indicates an atrioventricular reentrant tachycardia. Finally, if the rhythm is irregularly irregular and there are no P waves present, but instead you can see fibrillatory waves, this is atrial fibrillation. Let's move on to the broad complex tachycardias. These are dangerous rhythms, so patients that have this require immediate medical attention. Each of these will have a ventricular rate greater than 100 beats per minute and a broad QRS complex. They can be divided into regular and irregular rhythms. If there are three or more broad abnormal QRS complexes in series that occur with regular intervals and have a similar height and shape, this is likely monomorphic ventricular tachycardia. Note, however, that some rhythms can mimic this. It is subsequently useful to be able to identify specific features that are only present with ventricular tachycardia. Look for fusion beats. These occur when supraventricular and ventricular impulses collide to produce a hybrid complex. Also, look for capture beats. These occur when occasional atrial impulses manage to reach the ventricles when it is not refractory, leading to a capture of sinus rhythm. If there are three or more abnormally shaped complexes that are irregularly spaced with varying height and shape, this is likely polymorphic ventricular tachycardia. Fusion and capture beats may also be present with this rhythm. If there is complete irregularity of the complexes and the rhythm, this is likely ventricular fibrillation. We'll now move on to look at the cardiac axis. The cardiac axis indicates the overall direction of electrical activity in the heart. Here we'll focus mainly on the outputs of lead 1 and AVF. The key concept to note here is that when electrical activity moves towards the ECG electrode, the QRS complex becomes positive. When it moves away, the QRS becomes negative. There are four presentations to be aware of. The normal axis. Electrical activity moves towards both lead 1 and AVF, resulting in two positive QRS complexes. Right axis deviation. Here, electrical activity moves away from lead 1, producing a negative QRS, and towards AVF, making the QRS positive. Left axis deviation. In this scenario, lead 1 is positive while AVF is negative. Lead 2 must also be negative to confirm left axis deviation. Finally, extreme axis deviation. Here, both QRS complexes are negative, typically caused by abnormal lead placement or ventricular tachycardia. Next, we move on to assessment of the waves and intervals. Let's start with the P waves. Observe the P waves in lead 2. The P waves represent atrial depolarization and should be less than 3 small squares wide and no more than 2.5 small squares tall. There are two presentations to look out for here. The first is P pulmonale, tall P waves which represent right atrial enlargement. This should be suspected if the P wave is greater than 2.5 small squares tall. The second presentation is P mitrale. This is caused by left atrial enlargement and presents with a P wave that has two notches separated by one small square, and the P wave has a total duration of greater than 3 small squares wide. Next, we move on to the PR interval. This is best assessed in the rhythm strip. The PR interval represents the time it takes for depolarization to spread from the atria to the ventricles and should be between 3 to 5 small squares in duration. There are two groups of presentations to review here. The first is the atrioventricular blocks, and the second is the pre-excitation syndromes. The atrioventricular blocks are caused by a delay or complete loss of conduction through the AV node or the bundle of His. There are four presentations to learn. First degree heart block presents with a PR interval greater than 5 small squares in length, and this duration is fixed. Second degree heart block is divided into two forms. The first is Mobitz type 1. This presents with a progressively increasing PR interval until an impulse is not conducted to the ventricles. This progressive prolongation of the PR interval is known as a Wenckebach phenomenon. Mobitz 2 presents with a fixed PR interval, but will drop a QRS complex due to a lack of conduction through the bundle of His. Third degree heart block shows complete dissociation between the atria and ventricles. P waves occur at regular intervals, but QRS complexes are generated separately by an accessory pacemaker. A shortened PR interval is seen in pre-excitation syndromes, where an accessory pathway connecting the atrium ventricles allows for early ventricular depolarization. This is an example of a pre-excitation syndrome. Note how the PR interval is shortened and QRS complex is lengthened by a delta wave. This diagnosis is known as Wolff-Parkinson-White and predisposes patients to an atrioventricular reentry tachycardia. Next, we look at the QRS complexes, and the QRS complex represents ventricular depolarization. Quickly review the QRS complexes in leads V1 to V6. The complexes should be narrow and less than 3 small squares in duration. Under normal circumstances, you should note that the R waves generally become bigger as we move from leads V1 to V6, and the S waves become smaller. This is known as good R-wave progression. Let's take a look at some diagnoses. To do this, we'll focus on V1 and V6. First up is left ventricular hypertrophy. This is characterized by thickening of the left ventricular muscle. The thickened muscle generates a larger electrical charge. The Sokolo-Lyon criteria suggests that left ventricular hypertrophy is likely to be present if the depth of the S wave in V1, added to the height of the R wave in either V5 or V6, is greater than 7 large squares. In our example here, the combined total is 8.5 large squares. Next up are the bundle branch blocks. Blocks of the left or right bundle branch cause asynchronous depolarization of the ventricles, and this produces broad QRS complexes and ST segment changes. Right bundle branch block is present if the QRS complexes are greater than 3 small squares in duration. There must be an RSR wave in V1 and a deep S wave with a duration equal to or greater than 1 small square in V6. In left bundle branch block, the QRS complexes are prolonged, meaning that they are equal to or greater than 3 small squares in duration. There must be a deep, broad S wave in V1 with elevation of the ST segment. In lead V6, there will be a completely broad, positive R wave that may be notched, and depression of the ST segment should be present. The mnemonic William Marrow can be used to remember the shapes of V1 and V6 in both left bundle branch block and right bundle branch block. Now we move on to the ST segment. Scan all territories of the ECG, looking at the anatomically grouped leads, the inferior, septal, anterior, and lateral views. The ST segment is usually flat, but elevation or depression of the ST segment is measured at the J point. ST elevation is significant if it is greater than 1 small square in 2 or more anatomically grouped leads. Let's take a look at some examples. In this next example, ST elevation is present in the inferior leads. Note that pathological Q waves are also present, suggesting significant myocardial injury. Pathological Q waves are confirmed by having a duration of greater than 1 small square or having a depth equal to or greater than 1 large square. In this final image, there is saddle-shaped ST elevation, which occurs throughout almost all territories. This is the typical appearance of pericarditis. Now we move on to T waves. Just like with the ST segment, we scan all territories to evaluate the T waves. T waves represent ventricular repolarization, and they are positive in all leads apart from AVR and V1. In the limb leads, they should have a height of no more than 5 small squares. In the chest leads, the height should be no greater than 10 small squares. This ECG shows T wave inversion. This is significant if the T waves have a negative depth of 1 small square or more and is present in 2 or more anatomically grouped leads. This is a typical finding in non-ST elevation myocardial infarction. If we take a step back and zoom out, you can see that there is deep T-wave inversion in leads V1 to V5. Deep T-wave inversion in leads V2 and V3 is a classic ECG presentation of Wellens syndrome, which is highly specific for critical stenosis of the left anterior descending coronary artery. The next presentation to be aware of is tall or peaked T-waves. Tall P-waves are significant if they are greater than 5 small squares in the limb leads and 10 small squares in V1 to V6. Tall T-waves are the first ECG change present in hyperkalemia. Finally, we review the QT interval. You can calculate the interval by hand, but for the rapid assessment, I recommend using the corrected QT interval, or QTC. This is usually located at the top of the ECG along with other calculated intervals. Here we look for QTC prolongation. The QTC is prolonged if it is greater than 440 milliseconds in males and 460 milliseconds in females. The QTC is important because prolongation, particularly above 500 milliseconds, can produce a deadly polymorphic ventricular tachycardia known as torsade de Pointes. Various drugs can prolong the QTC, so keep an eye out for these in the history. This brings us to the end of the show. Like, subscribe, and share with your friends. Don't go anywhere. Medical Legend is next.